good to be with you today. A few of you are here, more of you are out there, and it's good to be with all of you today. I will say that maybe next week will be lights, camera, action. The new equipment has already been installed on the back wall, and we will get a training. Some people are getting a training this week. It won't be me. I don't want to know how to use it. I can't learn another new thing. And so we will be getting training on that this week, and hopefully next week we will take the tripod off of the communion table that's holding my phone and give you a little better view when you're in here, and hopefully a better view and a better sound for those that are remaining at home. So fingers crossed next week. If not next week, surely next. But let's not count our chickens before they hatch. Is that how it goes? Because we're in a global pandemic and nothing goes like we expect, right? Let me mention a couple of things. We will have our midweek meetup this week, 6 o'clock. Join us on Facebook Live. Dan will be leading our midweek meetup this week. The youth tonight are meeting at the Brockmans, and Jamie has that address. She's texted or sent out an email to parents already. But if you need that, look for Jamie and text her, email her or something to get that. 6 o'clock, 6 to 7, rain or shine, there's a rain plan there. So we will meet there, but it's not supposed to rain. I asked Siri, and she said it wasn't. So there you go. In your newsletter next week, the schedule for Advent is coming out. Wow, how different it will be this year. And yet we're trying to do some things that feel the same as much as we possibly can. And so check out your newsletter for an Advent schedule of all the things that we are still offering, and everything as much as we can do will be online as well. Roof Above is the new name for what we have known as Room in the Inn for these many years, and that is going to be very different this year. We will not be a location for people to come to, but there will be opportunities for us to volunteer and help at the locations where we will be housing folks that need a safe and warm place to rest at night. And one of the things we'll be doing, I know, is making sandwiches. You make the sandwiches, bring them by here, we'll deliver them. Dan will have a lot of information about that, so just keep an eye out for how you can be involved with that. I think that's all the announcements this morning. I invite you now to worship God in spirit and in truth.
Our opening litany this morning comes from the book of Galatians. St. Paul instructs the church at Galatia, bear one another's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. This is a good word for the church in a day when so many are hurting and in need. In further elaborating this idea of service, Paul then encourages the church, let us not grow weary in doing what is right, for we will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. Let us not grow weary in doing what is right. Let us be emboldened by those words today, and let us find strength for the road ahead. This is your response line for this morning's opening litany. Let us not grow weary in doing what is right. Let us not grow weary in doing what is right. God's children gather to worship, to be reminded of our Christ-like calling to bear one another's burdens. May worship remind us of that calling and give us strength. Let us not grow weary in doing what is right. When a stranger, down and out, needs a handout, a pure gift to sustain them through the day, let us not grow weary in doing what is right. When friends stumble and need a hand up, a helping hand to lighten the load, let us not grow weary in doing what is right. When enemies strike with words or other weapons, let us not be tempted to return evil for evil. Jesus taught a different way, a more excellent way of love, but we must have courage. Let us not grow weary in doing what is right. On the darkest days, through the longest ways, let us not grow weary in doing what is right. Be encouraged this day, friends of God, for the ways you are already bearing one another's burdens, and be strengthened for the days ahead. Let us not grow weary in doing what is right. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we come this day that you might bear our burdens this morning, that we might cast our cares on you and know the strength that comes from being part of a community of faith, from reaching out to you, that we might gain strength internally, strength that would give us courage for the days that lie ahead. So this day we gather that we might be strengthened, that you might strengthen our hearts, giving us good cheer, come what may. That you might strengthen our souls, that our faith might give us courage when the road is long. Strengthen our minds, that we might think clearly when there is so many other voices competing for our thoughts. Strengthen us for the journey, O God, that we might know you are with us, come what may. And hear us now as we pray the prayer that Christ taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We have trouble recognizing God's kingdom, even as it is coming among us. But God looks on us with mercy and love, ready to forgive, even as we hesitate to speak of our own waywardness. Let us keep silence together. Now I invite you to join me in saying our prayer of confession. Loving and merciful God, Once again, we must confess our struggle to be faithful disciples. Entrusted with all your gifts, we become fearful again of misusing them, missing the chance to be a blessing to others. Invited to dance in the light of your love, we stand against the wall again, afraid to reveal the brokenness that we so desperately try to hide. Called to serve those who struggle in life, we recognize again our tendency to criticize and to blame them for the poor choices they make. Have mercy, God. Once again, open our eyes to your kingdom in our midst, so we might discover that your day of hope and grace has already come in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And know that even as that day of hope and grace has come, you are loved and you are forgiven. So be at peace.
Extraordinarily difficult task of caring for a loved one, Only occasionally has selfishness or greed stood in the way of a family doing the right thing. On those occasions, I did not say it. Because these are holy words, in my opinion. They mean something. These words, "well done, good and faithful servant," are lifted right out of Scripture, ripped right out of the mouth of Jesus, and they are reserved for those who live up to the honor and integrity that they imply. Most of the time, the good and faithful servants are sitting on the first row on my far right. Most of the time, I get a lump in my throat when I get to that sentence in the eulogy. I try to look them directly in the eye when I say it. And often when I do, they drop their head and cry. These words are a blessing, a balm for a tired and weary and grieving soul. I've said these words to many of you. I've said them to people I've known well, and I've said them to people that I've hardly known, but using what I've learned about them through the testimony of others, I have found a way to say them. I've said them to my brother and my sister and their spouses at my mother's funeral. I've said these words on other occasions as well, in mission trip experiences or in situations when people have gone above and beyond the call. WDGAFS, well done, good and faithful servant. We live in a world of so much bad news and hear about the shenanigans of those who would do so much harm that sometimes it's hard to remember that there are more people out there that deserve a well done, good and faithful servant than not. In all the times and in all the circumstances that I have said it, never once, not one time, was it in the context of money, investments, or a portfolio. Never once did I say it about someone and how they played the stock market. Never once have I said it about someone's business acuity. Not once. This phrase is always reserved for someone's character and integrity and moral compass. This phrase is for someone's generosity of spirit and compassion. This phrase speaks to someone's ability to love one another, care for one another, give themselves away for another. For me, it has nothing to do with money. And yet the only place "well done, good and faithful servant" is found is smack dab in the middle of a parable that is confounding and not all that Jesus-y in some places. Has anyone else noticed how I keep getting the tough parables of Jesus that have him saying the harshest of things? Anybody notice that that's me? Yeah, Russ has noticed. I see that hand right there, Russ. "Well done, good and faithful servant" is located in the middle of the parable of the talents. Talent being money, a measurement of money. It's found in Matthew's gospel. Here's how this teaching story goes. "For it is as if a man," it is what is the kingdom of heaven. He said that previously, and he's just extending the story. So it's as if the kingdom of heaven is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then the property owner went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, I'm sure proudly, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have 5 more for you.' And his master replied to him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. The same thing happened with the guy too. Exact same words. And then the one with, well, I'll read it. And the one with two talents came forward saying, Master, you handed over to me two talents. See, I've made two more talents. Master said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of the master. Then the one who had received the one talent also came forward saying, Master, I knew you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours. And the master replied, you wicked and lazy slave. You knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with 10 talents, for to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Thank you, Jesus. Is that not the worst? I mean, seriously, Russ. This parable comes immediately after the one I preached about last week about the bridesmaids keeping their lamps trimmed and burning for the bridegroom. That parable began, then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. And Jesus told them this story to keep alert and ready and always be ready. And that parable led directly into this parable of the talents. Let's keep in mind that when Jesus says that the kingdom of heaven is like this, it doesn't mean that the kingdom is that thing. It's just kind of like that thing. It's not that thing. Perhaps because weddings are something that everyone would have understood, Jesus often used those images to convey a bigger truth, like last week with the bridesmaids and the bridegroom. And maybe because money always catches our interest and attention, he sometimes uses money to teach an important lesson. I really don't mean to tell Jesus how to do his job. But it's rather unfortunate that he uses money here, because we are so compelled by financial investments and riches that we get lost on the deeper truth of this story. The kingdom is like this does not mean that the kingdom is this. In other words, the kingdom is not about making more money. Let us be very clear about that. I'm convinced that the kingdom has nothing to do with monetary riches, but because it's a topic of such huge interest and importance to folks, I think Jesus often uses the topic of money to drive home a point. He knew we would be paying attention if he just talked to us about money. Another thing to keep in mind about this parable: the accolades go to the wise investors of the man's property. Even in using the example of money, the slaves were not investing for themselves. They weren't keeping the profits and building their own fortune. They were doing what was in the best interest of another. We're tempted to hear this parable and then pat ourselves on the back when we are savvy with our investments. These guys were working for someone else. It was not for themselves to get ahead, but they were working for someone else to get ahead. Again, I'm really not trying to imply that the master teacher messed up here, but I wish I could have suggested to Jesus that he try telling the story with a different kind of currency. I know it wouldn't have been as effective, because we all do love a good story about how important it is to make more money. Jesus knew this would be the way to bring it home, get our attention with real impact. Jesus knew that money was our number one motivator and common theme that all would understand. But let's admit it, it's just hard to hear Jesus throwing people into outer darkness where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth because he or she wasn't a good financial investor. That just doesn't sound like the Jesus we know and love and follow. Surely, just because someone played it safe with the cash by putting it under the mattress instead of in a high-yield fund, that wasn't enough to banish you to outer darkness of weeping and gnashing. That place sounds terrible. And frankly, it's a bit drastic, rash, and I find it impulsive to call the guy that buried it in his backyard wicked and lazy. That's harsh. So just for fun, I tried filling in the talent, the money issue here. I tried filling that in with something else. Say food, for example. I thought about the parable this way. The man gave food to the slaves, and he let them find ways to make the food multiply and feed the hungry. You know, one of my favorite stories in the Bible, it's not a parable, the story of the feeding of the 5,000. Oh, it's just miraculous that a little bit of bread and fish fed that many people. I'm just so utterly convinced that the miracle of that story was that when they found out they didn't have enough food, and the disciples were like, what do we do? What do we do, Jesus? What do we do? Jesus said, look, this boy has some food here. And when people saw the boy sharing his food, they realized they had food too and started to share it. Before they knew it, everybody was sharing one with another because it was not a global pandemic and people could be together and eat. Oh, for the day that comes. Well, the miracle of that story is the generosity of the food. So, what if the man gave food to the slaves and he let them find ways to make food multiply to feed the hungry? You know, kind of like the way we already have more food, it's just not distributed equitably. We already have more than enough food, it's just not distributed equitably. You know the way we throw away so much food? How much waste of food there is in our homes and in our restaurants while people are going hungry on our streets, digging through our trash to find ways to eat? Don't you think that that's sort of akin to burying it in the backyard? It's such a waste. That kind of activity among us kind of seems deserving of a wicked and lazy pronouncement. Though I do think that outer darkness and weeping and gnashing of teeth is horrific, the fact that we've not found ways to multiply food to feed the hungry or build affordable housing to shelter the disadvantaged might just be an appropriate consequence for our inaction. And isn't that what this parable is about? Our inaction? When we've been given something, whether it be money or some other type of riches, and we hoard it or squander it or bury it, when we don't work to increase it for the sake of another, isn't that outer darkness kind of stuff? And all of a sudden, this parable steps all over our toes. Let's keep playing with the story. What if it had been talents like we understand that word, talents? Like music, for example. What if Mark never sat at a keyboard or never sat on the organ bench? Or what if he just sat alone and played only for himself? Do you understand what music does to heal our soul? Just imagine if Mark had this talent and didn't work to increase it, but just kept it all to himself. How empty would our worship be? Or think of other artists that paint or act or dance or write. Do you have these talents and yet do not share them to heal the world? Jesus is saying that would be a travesty. Don't bury your talent. Use it, invest it, increase it. I think Jesus was trying to tell us that the kingdom is just like this. Those who take what they've been given and multiply it for the good of another, whether it be food or money or music, Jesus will say to you, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have in abundance." All of God's people want an abundance. What do you have that you can multiply and give away? Food? Clothes? Money? What do you have that you can multiply and give away? Music? Poetry? Art? What do you have that you can multiply and give away? Compassion? Grace? Love? If you bury any of these things in the ground, if you hide them from the world, you will not receive your reward. And what's the greatest reward of all? To hear those sacred and holy words spoken to you. Well done, good and faithful servant. What more on this earth could we possibly want than to hear that? Well done, good, faithful servant. Maybe so. Amen.
Will you pray with me? God, grant us courage to not allow fear to paralyze us. Grant us peace to step into uncertainty. Grant us hope to believe in brighter days. Grant us grace to criticize less and listen more. Grant us safety to live freely and openly. Grant us just enough discomfort to shine your light and love in the world. And through it all, may we have enough faith to take risks, to open homes and make pound cakes, to carve wood into art. May we use music to sustain, to make sandwiches and pack snacks to sort. May we give food. May we sew masks and dresses, to open yards and homes, to send cards and pumpkin bread. God, as our courage overcomes fear, may our giving and receiving create change. May our courage see abundance rather than scarcity. Amen.
Well, the preacher just said that Jesus knew he could keep our attention if he just talked about money. So let me talk about money for just a moment. Amy and I have thanked you throughout this year for the way that you have continued to be faithful to this congregation. Those are not hollow words. We mean that we have been able to sustain our strength as a congregation, worshiping together, our young people meeting together, mission opportunities that Dan has put forward for us, music opportunities. We are so grateful for your faithful giving to this congregation. And now we come to the season of commitment as we look toward next year, and we look forward to your continued faithfulness as we go into 2021. You should have received in the mail a packet for our 2021 annual ministry plan. The increase for next year is 0.3125%. We tried to keep that flat. There are some utilities that have to increase a little bit. We have to pay those. Our personnel expenses are flat. We've decreased a few of our expenses. Our increase is less than 0.5%. Amy and I have already turned in our pledge card, and we'll increase our giving next year by 1%. We'd encourage you to join us. Next Sunday is Commitment Sunday. And if you have not sent in your pledge card, you can bring it with you if you're going to be here. If you're not going to be here, you can mail it in. The easiest way to do this, and you can do this right now, today, send an email to allison@parkroadbaptist.org and just say, put me down for what I gave last year, 1% more, whatever. Take care of it right now. Next week, another opportunity, following Commitment Sunday at 2 o'clock, I will be outside under the carport. And if you would like to drive by, I have a small gift for you. And my books are supposed to be in this week. And if you'll drive by and hand me your pledge card, I'll give you one of my books. I'll even sign it for you. And I'll give you another small gift. And we'll finish up Commitment Sunday next week that way. Would you do that? Would you help us finish this up next week? You got 1 week, all right? Help us take care of that. We're so grateful. We're so grateful for your faithful giving this year. Well done, good and faithful servant. For our offertory, May May Ma comes to play her cello. She is a bright and talented young high school student. I heard May May practicing before worship began, and I'm so grateful she has not buried her talent in the backyard, but she's here to play for us today. We welcome May May to our service.
Thank you.
look forward to our new system being up in place so that those of you that are at home can read the meditations that we actually have up on the screen. I'll read to you. The first part of this is a George Bernard Shaw. I'm of the opinion that my life belongs to the whole community, and as long as I live it, it is my privilege to do whatever I can. I want to be thoroughly used up when I die. I think that is a good word. But we have another good word for this day. Let's come and introduce new members.
After our sanctuary had been closed for about 6 months, not a soul in this room, we had an opportunity to have a wedding. Ekaterina Ryskova and Eric Gonzalez, a beautiful, wonderful story that I'll tell you some other time. But Ekaterina and Eric came and we had a wedding and their friends and family were gathered in this room. It was a wonderful way for us to reopen our sanctuary after 6 months. And today they come. Ekaterina is not new to us. She's been one of our choral scholars singing with our sanctuary choir for several years now. Eric comes to join with us and we're so delighted to welcome both of them and have them as official members at Park Road. Ekaterina and Eric, our word to you is that we promise to be the church to you and with you as long as we're together, and we hope that'll be a good long time. And I'm not the only one, and Amy's not the only one, but all of you will share with Eric and Ekaterina your excitement and let them know how delighted you are that they've come today by saying amen.
Amen.
That's a pretty hearty amen, even through all those masks. So welcome, Ekaterina and Eric. We're delighted to have you. I'm so sorry that everybody can't greet you this morning and hug you and tell you their names. But as soon as we get all these masks off and you can see them, tell them who you are and welcome them to Park Road Baptist Church. We're delighted to have you. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's it?
Okay, that's it. We invite you to remain seated as Mark plays the closing voluntary, and then you'll be escorted out row by row so that we don't get too many people blocked up in the aisles, so that we keep our distance from one another. For those of you that are here face to face, it's good to see your faces. I hope that you feel safe. I feel that the guidelines that we have put in place are working. And for those of you that are comfortable, more comfortable staying at home, we hope that you still feel connected to us. We love seeing your name. We love seeing your comments. We do feel like we're all in this together. For however long it lasts, we are committed to that. This will be the last time you see me for a few weeks. I have surgery tomorrow and I'm going to be out for several weeks. Hope to be back in time for Christmas Eve. So I will be out there watching with you all. And critiquing the sound and telling them to turn it up. Yeah, Bruce is fairly excited about that. I will give you all the, I'll be texting you during worship to tell you all the things that are going well.
Thank you.
You're welcome. The final word is not ours, but the Lord. So hear this good word of benediction as we go. We're on the wrong side.
I can't do this remotely. May the Lord bless you and keep you.
May God's face shine upon you. May God be gracious to you.
May God give you grace this day to love with all your heart.
That you might do justice.
To love with all your soul.
That you might show mercy.
To love with all your mind.
That you might walk humbly with your God.
As you go into the world this day, dear friends, love the Lord your God with all your strength.
And love your neighbor as yourself.
Thank you.
Great to see all of you. Thanks for being here.